this is a very personal presentation. Arun, he's an engineer, chemical engineer, gold medalist, but his passion has been music. He has been learning music for, I don't know, years together, and he was one of the main pupil learning from Kishori Amonkar, and his specialty is Jaipur Gharana. He has some finest unheard live recordings of Kishori Tai, and he is going to explain the changes that she brought remaining in Jaipur Gharana in years to come, and he will be playing the recordings. Along with that, he will also demonstrate the changes by singing. So once again, thank you, Arun, for being here, and I'm sure all of us are going to enjoy this evening. All the best.
Thank you very much, Jaising Bhai, for your kind hospitality and hosting this wonderful evening here. The theme of this presentation today is the music of Gaana Saraswati Kishori Amonkar, who was my guru for many years. And we have her photo here, very nice photo. And I look at her musical career from a bird's eye view because of the fact that I was associated with her as a disciple for many, many years. And also later associated with her through her musical journey for many years. And an overall period of, say, about almost 50 years, 45 years. I divide her musical career into two segments. If the first half of her long journey was between the years of, say, 1960 until 1985. And the second half of her musical journey was from 1985 until the time she passed away. And it so happens, we had wanted to have this event as close as possible to her first death anniversary, which happened on the 3rd of April last year. But we are close to it anyway. The first half of her career has not been heard much by, at least by the present generation, the younger generation. I'm sure those of you who are close to my age have heard her during those early years. And but the most important thing for me was to present her, the aspects of her music, of her earlier part of her life, which were distinctly different from the way her music evolved in the latter half of her career. And both parts, is, by the way, have their own brilliance, their own creativity of a certain type, and yet they are very distinct from each other. So the objective of this evening is to focus on that first half of her music career between 1960 and 1985. I'm going to do this with commentaries on several aspects of what her music was then. And parts of that style, of course, persisted later, but parts of that style essentially disappeared over time. And this happens perhaps to most eminent musicians, that they evolve. No highly accomplished musician remains very constant in his approach, or his or her approach, his or her concepts and interpretations of our music system, of ragas, our presentation of the ragas and the elements of the presentation, and so on. My commentaries, I'm going to intersperse them with live recordings of Kishori Thai from that era. It so happened that for many years, particularly in her early career years, whenever she sang in Mumbai, she always asked me personally to record every concert, which I did with those reel-to-reel tape recorders we had in those days. And I carefully preserved all those reels, 7-inch reels. There were some others who used to do recordings also for her, but whether I did them or others did them, she handed over all those spools to me for safekeeping, for custody. And that is because her house was oftentimes like a dharmashala. And people would go and come and go, come and go, and nobody knew who came and who went, and these spools would lie around, and people would just pick them up quietly and put them into their bag and sack and walk away. So for that not to happen, she asked me to take custody of these. Now, in Bombay weather, these analog tapes, the Bombay weather is a menace to these analog tapes. And this is not so in drier places like Pune or Nagpur or Ahmedabad. In Bombay, they, within 6 to 8 months, if they are not played or handled, they all begin to accumulate a small monolayer of fungus. And then after some time, if that fungus is not cleaned, it entrenches into the tape material so hard that the tape essentially becomes unusable, unlistenable. So what I used to do was, I'm giving all you this background as to how difficult it was to preserve her music of that time. That I used to periodically, every 6 months or so, run these tapes on the tape recorder in a fast forward or fast reverse mode with a cotton wool, ball of cotton wool dipped in isopropyl alcohol, hold it against the tape as it's running fast, and clean it off the fungus. And this had to be done periodically to all these gigantic collection of spools. But I did that meticulously as my service to my guru, but more than that, my service for the sake of posterity, for future generations of listeners. Eventually, as technology progressed, we had digitization possible and computerization possible, and now all those reels I have myself personally digitized into music files. And not only digitized, but with a very good editing software, I have edited them to reduce the noise, reduce the tape hiss, to take out unwanted passages like tabla going out of tune in a concert, so then taking 2 minutes to retune the tabla and this kind of a thing. Not only that, but also her bouts of coughing. Now, it's not easy to remove selectively without shortening the distance between two matras. By simply deleting that part, you would shorten the distance between two matras, and that would distort. So to preserve the distance and yet remove the coughing episodes or short coughs, there is a technique which I adopted, and with this software I did all of that work very meticulously, and this used to take me hours to do one reel edited. But we brought all of these reels now to essentially studio quality recordings. So that's the background of these recordings that you are going to hear today. Unfortunately, it's impossible to present all the illustrative examples of these recordings in a short 3-hour program, because each khayal is like 45 minutes, 50 minutes, sometimes 1 hour. So what I have done for the sake of this program is taken my illustrations, and those long live recordings, I have reduced them, made them concise to about 8 to 10 minutes each. And I have done that so that salient parts of each recording which I'm trying to illustrate are brought there, and they are matched to the matra to matra, first beat to first beat, so you don't feel any much discontinuity between them. So that's also a very laborious process that I've done. So all of that is now done, and then I'm going to now present my various points about her music. So let me begin by the fact that most people, present generation people, who have heard her for the last 25, 30 years, have heard her emotional side of rendering or presenting a khayal, in Hindustani classical khayal, quite a lot of emotional based. And there has been a criticism, to some extent justifiably, that in doing so, she departed from the very strict disciplinarian side of the Jaipur Gayaki. Jaipur Gayaki has the very character of Shuddhata of the sound, the voice, the ah sound, the akar as we call it. And the relationship between the alap and the lay, the theka, it's laikari with respect to the words of the bandish, interspersed and showing the relationship, one-to-one correspondence between the utterance of the words of the bandish, of the lyrics, with the bowls of the tabla. These are the kind of special characteristics of the Jaipur Gharana. And the old masters like Kesarbhai Kerkar or Mugubhai Kurdikar, there are so many, I won't list all of them, very meticulously used to present this kind of a Jaipur Gharana style. Kishori Thai had a lot of that influence in her early life, but that influence became less and less as she progressed towards the later part of her life. It's not a criticism, it's just that it became a different, slightly different type of music compared with the first half. So I am going to present to you today a very concisely compiled bandish in it's a 1978 recording of Sauni Kalyan, and you will see there a very disciplined presentation of the Jaipur style.
Yeah.
Please notice the relationship of the alap as it proceeds, and its relationship with the theka, with the lay that's going on. How beautifully they are intertwined. And this is the main character of Jaipur Gayaki, which she had very prominently in her singing in those days. Here is the laikari I was talking about. The words of the lyric, play them with the theka and the bowls of the tal.
Yeah.
This was a short 13-minute excerpt from an original Savani Kalyan, which was 1 hour long. Now I'll turn to another topic. That is the Shrutis of Hindustani music. In my humble opinion, no vocalist has done as much research and as much thought has been given to the place of Shrutis in our various ragas and the emotion that the Shrutis produce. No one has done this as extensively as Kishori Tai has done. As a matter of fact, she was for years together, and I've seen this with my own eyes, she had a scholarly attention to the old ancient treatises on Hindustani music or Indian music, let's say, and the place of Shrutis in our notes and ragas. So Sangeet Ratnakar is an ancient treatise, and Bharata Muni is Natya Shastra. She extensively studied these. In fact, she had someone teach her translation of those verses from Sanskrit to understand what they meant. And the concept of Swayambhu Gandhar, that's the note ga, which is in our Indian scale of the octave from one sa to the next sa, how that is divided into these 7 major notes and 5 komal and tivra notes. It's the same scale that is present on piano or harmonium or accordion or any of these wind instruments or discrete sound instruments. The Western system of dividing this scale is to simply divide this entire frequency range, which is actually the one note, the lower note, and its corresponding upper octave note has exactly a 2-to-1 ratio of frequencies. So if sa is 212 hertz, then the upper sa would be 424 hertz. But the division between these two frequencies into 12 different notes, in Western scale of music, it is pretty much simply an arithmetic division, equal frequency differences. So 12 equal parts. Not so in Indian or Bharatiya music. In Hindustani music, it is the notes are formed by a relationship of ratios. It's a geometric kind of a progression. So if you take sa as a certain frequency, then the note pa is defined by 1.5 times the frequency of the sa. If you multiply the frequency of the sa by the ratio 4/3, you arrive at the note ma, and so on. So you take the ma and then again multiply by a frequency of 4/3, then you get the ma of the ma, which turns out to be ni. Okay? And then the next sa is obviously automatically, it's twice the frequency of the first sa. So and the remaining notes are derived by taking the 4/3 and 3/2 ratios of in between notes. And correspondingly, as they lead to the higher and higher of those notes, they turn out to be the dhas and the pas, and the knees and the komal dhas and the komal rays and so on. So the whole structure of whole notes, all the notes of our Indian Hindustani scale are derived from these ratios with respect to the starting frequency of the sa. It's a very complicated, and therefore, it so turns out that the Western scale of a piano or a harmonium is approximately the same as the notes that you derive with this ratio calculations, but not exactly. There could be 1.5 or even 2% difference between the frequencies calculated by the Indian scale as compared with the Western scale. And that is why if you take a harmonium or a piano and you try to play a Hindustani rag on it, to a well-trained ear, it doesn't sound good. Because the notes of our ragas, the Yaman, Bhoop, Miyaki Todi, or whatever ragas we take, Malkaus, the place of those shrutis, as derived from our ratio manipulations, calculations, are slightly different from those. So a good discerning musician, harmonium is not a welcome instrument for accompaniment. It's a convenience instrument. It's easy to play. Really, the instrument that you should have is a sarangi, or even violin for that matter. Any instrument that has a continuum of notes doesn't have the discreteness of the notes. That's the right instrument for our Hindustani music. That's why veena, sarangi, but not dilruba, not harmonium, are our musical instruments. Anyway, I'm digressing. So she paid very, very special attention to the place of shrutis in our ragas. And various ragas have perhaps the same, notation-wise, the same note. Miyaki Todi has a re, komal re. Bhairav has a komal re. Multani has a komal re. Now, all these komal rays on harmonium is one single key. But in all these three or four or five, or Marwa has a komal ray. If you take all these ragas, which have the same komal ray in them, they have different shrutis. And the komal ray of Miyaki Todi does not sound the same as the komal ray of Bhairav, does not sound the same as the komal ray of Marwa, does not sound the same as the komal ray of Multani. And she paid extremely meticulous attention to these. And I'm going to now play an example, and there are so many examples I could have played, but we have to finish this in good time. So I'm going to take the example of Kaushi Kannada. Kaushi Kannada is a Mishra Rag, mixed rag. It's a mixture of Darbari Kannada and Malkaus. Now, but Darbari Kannada and Malkaus, both ragas have a komal ga and a komal ni in their scale. Now, Kaushi Kannada is a mixture of the two. The komal ga of Darbari Kannada has a slightly lower shruti, even compared with the scale calculated by our ratios. That's not still the ultimate. Even that ga, which is calculated by our system, that ga also can be a slightly lower than what is calculated, or slightly higher than what's calculated, and these are what we call shrutis, microtones, apart from the major 12 notes. And one might say, how many shrutis are there? It's like saying, how long is a piece of string? It's like, how many colors are there in a rainbow? Infinite. It's a continuum. But humanly discernible, one could say, I mean, shastras have said that there are 22 shrutis. Now, I don't believe there are 22 or 21 or 18 or 24. It's how sharp your ear is. Coming back to the example, the komal ga of Malkaus is slightly higher than the komal ga of our Hindu scale. Komal ga of the Darbari Kannada is slightly lower than that ga. Okay? Komal ni of the Malkaus is slightly higher. Now, komal ga of the Malkaus is slightly higher. Komal ni of the Malkaus is slightly lower than the normal komal ni. And the komal ni of Darbari Kannada is slightly higher than the normal komal ni. So komal ni is higher, komal ga is lower in Darbari Kannada. Komalga is higher and Komal Ni is lower in Malkaus. Now imagine keeping track of this. First of all, mastering those subtle differences from the real Komalga, slightly higher and slightly lower, and Ni. She did that. And it's not fluke. Sometimes you just sing it and sometimes you don't. To consistently place your voice on that specific Shruti, when you are showing the Darbari Kannada Anga, Darbari Kannada side of that rag, your Komalga and Komalni should be the Darbari Kannada variants. And when you are showing in that same rag the Malkaus side, those have to be the Malkaus side of variants. And you got to keep that consistently throughout your rendering of the whole rag. That is why she was such a genius. No one came close to her in the Shruti differences. And that is why, by and large, audiences would have tears in their eyes when she sang Mia Ki Todi, Rishabh Gandhar. The Komal, Ati Komal, we call it Ati Komal, we don't even call it Komal. Ati Komal Rishabh, Ati Komal Gandhar of rag like Mia Ki Todi. Only two artists in my living memory mastered that. She was one of them, Pandit Bhimsen Joshi was the other. No one else came close to it. Sorry to say this, but my humble opinion. Let's play something in Kaushi Kannada, in that she herself explains this difference, by the way, in her own words. It's interesting to hear that. Darbari. She said it's far kathine. Now I'm going to the next topic, which is about her maverick nature. She was, by her very nature, She was a rebel. And her philosophy was that there is a limit to which you should confine yourself to the grammar of music and free yourself where your emotions might lead. So long as you don't completely destroy the rag, take such liberties as would add to the beauty of that rag. And there were times when she went to quite severe extremes with that attitude of hers and attracted a lot of criticism from the pandits of music. But she didn't care. She said, I will seek where I find beauty. And if I find that beauty, I will seek it and I will sing it. I have two excellent examples of how she went completely out, not completely out, but significantly out of the usual norms of the rag. I have an example of Shuddha Kalyan and also an example of Bageshri. I'll play just one of the two for lack of time. The Shuddha Kalyan, first let me give a little explanation. Shuddha Kalyan is a rag which is in commonly heard and commonly sung in all gharanas. It's not a Jaipur gharana specialty or anything like that. Now this rag differs from rag bhoop. Both of them have essentially the same main notes. When I say main notes, basic notes. And in Shuddha Kalyan differs from bhoop is by the fact that the, in addition to the sare ga pa dha sa, the usual five notes, there is also a sliding touch to the tivra ma, which is between the pa and the ga, in the descent. One takes the sa re ga pa pa, bhoop will go pa ga re ga pa ga. Shuddha Kalyan will sa re ga pa ga. So you touch the tivra ma. And likewise, near the sa, instead of taking straight from sa to dha, you take a sliding around the note ni. But as convention goes, this sliding is to be done in the descent only, not in the ascent. Now she rebelled against this rule. She would say, why not in the ascent? If I can do it very skillfully and if I can add a little more higher touch of beauty to that, just because the Shastra said so, no, I'll do it. And I'm going to play an example of her Shuddha Kalyan. Again, abridged, a small, it still extends for about 10 minutes, I think, 14 minutes. We will cut short. After I've illustrated the point, we'll stop. But pay attention to that sliding from pa to ga and the sliding from sa to dha. Avroha is fine, but see that the way she approaches them in the aroha or in the ascent, almost giving you a little feel of Yaman, where these two notes are predominantly sung in the ascent. But not quite reaching the Yaman. Staying short of Yaman, going beyond bhoop, in the ascent, touching the ma and the ni. In Marathi, we call it bandakhori. Okay, here we go. Thank you. You see that? Sa ni da ni da re. Da ni da re. Now that ni is in ascent, not really allowed, but she's done that. See that sa re ma ga re ga ma, that is really not allowed in Shuddha Kalyan. Re ga pa ma ga, sa re ga re ma ga pa ma ga. So she approaches that through an ascent, that Tivra Madhyam. These are the things which she used to do, and it sent a little bit of a miniature shockwave with those certain people would anyone who's trying to dozing off suddenly would wake up. What's going on?
Thank you.
where she is showing the knee in the aroha. Let's turn to another topic. I'm going to talk about her very special attention to the pronunciation of the words of the bandish, of the song, of the lyric. She was extremely particular that the emotion that the bandish portrays has to be preserved, has to be carefully sung in the way you sing these words. And usually the bandishes that she chose, amongst many that she knew, were complementing the mood of the rag itself. So the bandish itself complements the mood of the rag. And then the way the words are, they further complement the mood, the emotion of that rag. I'm going to play an example of her very old clip here. It's in rag Bihari. It's a 1977 recording. Rag Bihari, a rather unusual rag, comes somewhat close to Tilak Kamod, but not quite. Now, this is a rag, the emotion of the rag itself, the bhav, the ras of this rag is viraharas, the mood of separation between two lovers. That is really the mood of this rag. And the bandish itself also depicts that same emotion. The words of the bandish are Re Neendana Aayi Nayanana Me. It's very simple, you can understand the meaning. Yeho Neendana Aayi Nayanana Me Piyake Dekhe Beko Mukha. Beko means beautiful. So what she's saying is that since I saw the beautiful face of my lover, I haven't been able to sleep. Antara, that is the Astai, the Antara goes, Umara Sari Bita Gai, Tumare Socha Me. Clear? Umara Sari Bita Gai, Tumare Socha Me. Sajile. Aba to aao, tabahi hove sukha. That's the Antara. Now when she used to teach this bandish, in the beginning we paid no attention to the bhav of this bandish. So first of all, it's hard for a man to feel that emotion. But nevertheless, she was very keen that you understand what the mood of the rag is and what the mood of the words is. And then you got to sing the way, how do you pronounce those words? How do you pronounce the word sajile? How do you say the line abato avo? Abato avo. Well, he will run away even further, I think. So, in Marathi we call it the arzava of a woman's calling. In this bandish, I would like you to pay attention not just to the rag, but the way she is singing these words. See the how she sings the word sajile, how she sings the word abato avo. And that was one of her characteristics of her music. Why her entire presentation became so enchanting, so appealing, so overwhelming for, by and large, most audiences, is because it was not just the purity of the notes, it was not just the application of the right shrutis, it was not just the balance of lay and sur, but these little nuances created that whole impact of the overall presentation of her music. Okay? So here we go, Bihari.
Ah.
noticed how she sang. That pleading, begging for him to come back. She was very particular about how to sing, how to say the words of the bandish. Not many artists pay that much attention to the lyrics. In Hindustani classical music, khayal is sung, bandish is taken, sam is taken, mukhda is taken. You sing that bandish once and you go on. And very hardly people would pay attention to what the words are, what they mean, what their feel is, and how that feel has to be the feel of that raga. It is said of a very, very renowned female artist, big artist of the past, who hardly paid any attention to the words. In fact, so bad that what she used to sing as the bandish, people could never understand what the words were when she sang them. So somebody had the daring to ask her, "Ki bhai, you sing these bandishes, we are trying to understand what the words are." She said, why do you bother about the words of the bandish? What the words have to do with the rag? I could as well say my postal address. So there was a stark contrast with this. Yeah. Now, what I'm going to do is play for you some ragas that Kishori Tai composed herself. And she very rarely sang those ragas in her later life. She sang quite a bit in the earlier life. And obviously there are quite a few, quite a lot of them, but I'm just going to play I think four examples. The first one I'm going to play is a rag called Adana Malhar, which she composed as a combination of the rag Adana with almost like Mia Malhar combination of the two. It's a 1975 recording.
Oh,
That was Adana Malhar. I'm going to play a 1977 recording of a rag she composed called Nanda Shri. And she never answered this question as to why she named it Nanda Shri. Because there, it's not a mixed rag. There is no element of Shri in it. There is no mixture with Bageshri or Rageshri. It's a stand on its own rag. But she called it Nanda Shri. There is, of course, there is a part of it which sounds like Nanda. Other than that. So, here it is.
Thank you.
Rag that she, one of the ragas is Lalat Bibhas. This is a combination of Lalat and Bibhas. So, which is obvious. In what you just heard, it did sound like it had shades of Bhinna Sharja and of course shades of Nanda. And that's the way it sounds to me. But why it's called Nanda Shri, I don't know. Here's Lalat Bibhas. She's saying Pancham Besu, referring to the Tanpura.
Yeah.
Is a rag she called Savan Gandhar, and again it's her own creation. I mean, she would just sometimes just think of something and she was just humming and would just sing. And this I like this rag. Well, what is the rag? I don't know, but I like it. So this is the way most of her compositions have been born. And that's the sign of a true artist, true brilliance. Pratibha, as we call it, is that you don't sit down and say, hey, today I'm going to compose a new rag, and then what can I do, what shall I do? Ragas don't get, they are not born like that. The really true good ragas, they just come off. Now, see, Savan Gandhar is one of them. If you see, you will see some shades of Kalavati and Malhar in this. Very beautiful composition. And by the way, all these ragas she composed, naturally she also composed the lyrics. The bandishes are also her own. I suspect the Gandhar word in this rag. First of all, the word Savan is probably because it has got the Malharang in it. And the reason the Gandhar word she has chosen here is that if you see this mukda, the upaj which you just heard, and you will hear it over and over, it suddenly, it comes down and then touches that ray and then lands into the ga so beautifully. That's and sudden and unexpected landing on the ga, Gandhar. And this, I think, is the reason the name Savan Gandhar.
Wow.